Listen, another sit down with Big Crit, hey, y'all. What's Apple Music One. It's the Ebro Show celebrating the new album, Digital Roses Don't Die.
Let's go.
Tell me what that means before I make any assumptions.
Okay, so for me, the idea of being digital was way before the world we in now. Like, my father was able to send me a photo of my grandmother and my grandfather when they were super young. And in my mind, I'm thinking, I can't imagine what they was thinking about when life and, like, what happens next kind of vibe. And so we've technically been passing down digital roses since we can remember. The idea of a concept of a photo or a moment with your family. And it's a very individual and what that means to you. And it goes from the people in the picture to the person that took the picture to the place they was at and that time period. And so it's just that idea of continuously not only curating these moments but documenting them so we can keep passing down these roses, these digital roses that really don't die, you know. And so and for me it was just trying to create an album based off the love I saw my grandparents have, based off the love and the love I've experienced in my life and what that even feels like in a sense, musically.
We hear a lot today, it's always talk of giving someone flowers.
Mm-hmm.
And so hearing that articulated like that is very dope because do you feel like you've been able to, throughout all your albums, it's so much about where you're from.
Yeah.
It's so much about black music. It's so much about the organic nature of creation and love and, you know, the metafors of women and cars.
Let's
go. And when all of the thing, you know. All
bars and let's go. Greatest rapper alive, yes. Yeah. Let's go.
All of that. And I don't think anybody's ever questioned your rapping abilities. So at this point in your career, where you are running your own business and your own merch and your own touring and your own albums and everything. When you set out to put together a project, what are you setting out to accomplish today? What's the motivation?
I think we all went through a lot, dude, 2020, 2021.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea of experiencing something was kind of cut short. You weren't traveling, you couldn't even see people you normally see. The idea of a community didn't exist. So me, it was like just watching. I knew that coming out of the pandemic, I didn't want to talk about the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And as angry and as frustrated or not even being able to grieve about loved ones, I knew that if I went into writing an album, I wanted to curate it in a way where it talks about something that's very baseline as humans. The idea of being loved, the idea of being happy, loss, but in a way of accepting it. Going through it personally, being grounded in it, and then being like, you know what, I still experienced it, though.
Mm.
And it's hard to do that musically sometimes, but I had ample amount of time to create this. It's not about one particular relationship, but through all of them, and even viewing relationships and what that means. And then putting it on a bed of music and being comfortable with the fact it doesn't sound like anything that's out right now. It's not about what's happening right now. But if you aren't in the space of would it matter to you, then you might be years down the road.
Mm.
And I made it specifically to not be a time stamp.
It's timeless.
Yeah, it's like you don't know when. Like more, and then even the outro record is like we still experienced it, though.
That's right.
You know, it's like we experiencing it, which is still beautiful in itself.
Explain to me the how you wove in earth, wind, fire, earth, earth, wind, fire.
Well, yeah, it's fire, earth, water, wind.
Water, that's the one.
I mean, obviously, people gravitate towards elements for starters, but I think of the fire being more the lust part of the album. It's when you just really trying to impress somebody you just met, like man, you know, you putting on
got
your best suit.
So the breakup of it is the is broken up into sections.
Yes, got very it. Much okay. into sections. And the very first four tracks is about the fire part, the lust part of meeting somebody. Then you get into the earth part, which is the groundedness. Well, that's when you're like, you know what, I'm done with all the game plan. Like I'm gonna really be with you, and I'm gonna find myself with you. And then the water part is when you become kind of content and complacent. It's like, all right, that's when you start showing them parts of yourself. It's like, you know what? I don't mind doing none of that no more. I'm not going to do that. We're going to kick it at the crib. No more dates. But you're comfortable in a sense. And then the wind part is when the turbulence happens, which happens in every relationship, where you hit that point where you decide, do you move forward with this person in your life? And that means children. That means marriage. That can mean another 5-10 years regardless. But it's like you have that choice and that option. And if it doesn't work out, you learn from it. If it does, you keep going.
You've been dropping projects since 2005 that are available on the service.
Yeah.
13 mixtapes, 5 EPs, 5 albums. And then obviously, I mean, you got...
plethora of features.
Yeah, I mean...
It just goes crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Catalog is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's crazy. How does that feel?
Longevity. I mean, what can you say, man? Most people found out about me in 2010, Glass House. I've been dropping music since 2001.
Mm-hmm.
So in my city, first mixtape, I pressed up myself, pushing in my city. 2005, I did the Chitlin circuits, you know what I'm saying, moving around. Then, so to be here at this point, it's like, it's a blessing in a sense. And people still want to hear what I'm talking about, bro. Come on, man.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Like, man. Yeah, I'm here with you. Like, come on, man.
But you also talk about it's not just what you talk about, it's the way you talk about it.
Thank you.
And I think that's the ingredient that is essential to not only longevity as an artist, but specifically in rap. I think there's a lot of, and I'm sure you experienced this as a young artist, you come in the game and you're like, yo, what do I need to do to be hot?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So you're just, you want to rap and you want to do it your way, but you also kind of are acknowledging, all right, what's the path to being on fire out here?
Yeah.
So you chase that and then you discover, I'm sure, when you go back and listen to your discography, I don't know how often you do that.
I do.
But you're like, damn, I was really on some flimsy right here. But well, I evolved as a human, right? And a man, right?
Yeah. Like, I mean, so me, it was, and that's what made it so difficult, because I wasn't never on some flimsy.
Right.
So it was like, oh, this my single. And it was like, this your single? I'm like, yeah, I got this here as my single.
Yeah.
It was like, ain't no features. It ain't, you know, ain't no tune. It's like, you cussing? Like, yeah, but this is what I do. You know, even with What You Mean You Ain't That, it's like, nah, this is a single. Money on the Floor. Yes, I'm going to feature A-Ball and MJG and 2 Chainz. This is my single.
Yeah.
So my issue was is that I never became flimsy in a sense. It was always like, nah.
But do you think that, I think your content's gotten more spiritual though, it's gotten more purposeful, it's gotten
deeper?
It was
always spiritual.
You feel like it was as deep then as it is now?
Man, even in country, I was talking about God in the second verse.
True, that's true.
I dropped the Vent in 2011, right? I got records like Free My Soul.
That's true.
Like I've been on this wave, like it never stopped, and it goes back farther than that. Because it's a part of where I'm from.
Right.
Me getting B.B. King on my album is still the highlight of my career.
That's right.
Seeking how I'm doing a record like Praying Man, whether people understood the concept of the record, whether they was on it at the time. Children of the World was one of my biggest records in 2010.
That record's fire.
But look what I was talking about.
Right.
And then A&R and that record was 2 years old at that point. Gang of A&R is like, bro, nobody don't hear that. People don't want to hear that. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is not new for me.
Right.
You know, and so even to be at a space where I do a Digital Roses Don't Die and I'm singing and all this funk, it's like, bro, Mind Control, I was doing funk. I got records like Shake It, I was doing funk.
You've been
like,
doing, musically, you've been
and
on.
It's always been me putting my entire life into my music creatively and never siding with what the industry wanted from me, because I could have did 30 country, bro. But it's like, man, no, it's bigger than that. Like, that's just a portion of where I'm from.
Yeah, you've been very dimensional for a minute. That's dope, man. Congrats, man.
Thank you, bro. Hey, look, hey, thank you. Yeah, okay.
That's dope, man.
Wisdom. I see the wisdom.
Let's get to Digital Roses Don't Die.
Yeah.
South Side of the Moon.
Yes, produced by DJ Camper.
Now, is this record a metaphor for hip-hop?
Yes.
I thought so.
Yes. It's an ado to hip-hop. Yeah. I mean, I remember watching BET Uncut, man. I've seen hip-hop go from so many different perspectives.
Yeah, yeah.
But even being a young kid and what my father listened to growing up and then what I found musically myself, but knowing that listening to hip-hop started in the East Coast and then really wanted to metaphorically draw a picture of that, you know, with my verses and then going to the West Coast and still wanting hip-hop to come to the South.
Mm-hmm.
Especially Mississippi, in a sense, and the respect we have for it, the amount of albums we listen to. And I tell people all the time, the top 10 records when I was growing up in Mississippi were not from the South on the radio. And even if you called in, it was somebody blowing up in your neighborhood, they weren't playing that. They was playing the top 10 records in the East Coast and West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I grew up knowing how the tempos, samples, how the drum cadences, and being able to flow on all these different kinds of pockets, because I grew up listening to it.
Well, and I think it's also, I don't think, given enough credit that the music that was being sampled in hip-hop records. It's not like that was just New York jazz. That was blue.
Yeah, it was New Orleans. You know what I'm saying? It was New Orleans.
James Brown is from Georgia. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the South. Country.
Muddy water. Yeah, it was
All that. You know what I mean? So I think sometimes we contort this hip-hop thing through just, like, it began in the East Coast. Yeah. I think the idea of sampling and technology and the Caribbean influence of DJs and partying and getting on the mic, that part of it. But black music and the backdrop of hip hop is that's the South.
Let's go. Like, look, let it go. Hey, Jay, you see it. I ain't gotta say much.
I mean, like it's I think we trivialize that a little bit.
I mean, but for me it's important that I come through and just as a reminder.
Yeah, for sure.
And then even
And also there is a specific South communal cultural experience as a MC that you're going to see things that are very that part of it is very different.
And I think, but see, the thing is with that is only because when you get ignored for so long, you just decide to create something for yourself.
That's right.
Hearing Pimp C and Bun talk about country rap tones made it to where it didn't matter whether people heard my music from anywhere else other than the South. Mm-hmm. I became very proud. Like I could just be underground king, and I'm cool with that. My music could be played in these places in the Chitlin' circuit, and I'd be fine.
Right.
So a lot of these artists that I listened to, once they got popular for the rest of the world, they was already legends to me anyway. Right. And I'm like, y'all late. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, but I got to give it up to the OGs because they laid that foundation to where, regardless, like Slim did, like already platinum. Like, that don't matter. Right. Like, you know?
Available in Spatial. Go check it out. Digital Roses Don't Die. Yeah, it's on Apple Music One.
Shout out to Walter Tucker, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Definitely.
Mix that up. Yeah. Real nice for you.
Definitely got it
right. I was listening to it. It's a great mix.
Like all the background vocals.
Yeah, everything.
You know, I'm singing on all that.
That's all you.
Well, no, so it's literally a relationship. And nobody can feature in your life. That's why there's no features. The only two vocalists is an amazing female vocalist named Roland. They're singing with me on a lot of the back and forth.
Okay.
And then I got the homie Modre doing the talk box and Show You Right. But other than that, it's all me, whether it's a bad note or not.
But you've sang on albums before.
Yeah, but that was out of necessity. That was out because I couldn't find nobody at the moment. I was like, I'm going to do it myself.
But you sound good, though.
Yeah, I mean, thank you. I mean, we got to get this live show right, though.
Are you worried about going out on that stage?
Nah, it's just because I know I'm a turn up, too. So imagine me doing country trying to sing so cool.
Yeah.
Like, my voice going to be destroyed.
It's going to be a little bit.
Yeah.
But you get it.
Nah, man, I got
How's your fitness? You been working out? You got a trainer?
I had a trainer before pandemic.
You going to start running some miles?
I already do that, bro. Whoa. I'm 750 calorie burn every time.
You know
Jump rope, cardio, all that shit.
Like, you going to be ready for country. And then going to so cool. You going to be ready.
I don't look nothing like I did last time I saw you. Hold up, bro.
Yeah. So what's your, talk to me about Road Clean.
Yes.
It's another one of my favorites on hand.
Yeah, so, Road Clean, I produced that record, but shout out to the musician that helped me really bring it to life. Shout out to Mike Harnett, Jared Alexander, Ashanti Man Violinist, Jay Brab. But, I mean, people know me for doing records where you could drive to. Yeah, but for me, it was like trying to create it in a way where it's not about the driver. It was like, I'm the dice in the windshield.
Got it.
And I'm in love with the car. And then it literally doesn't get in the way. It's not about being bass heavy. It's just a song about the summer and driving.
Are you, how many cars you got right now?
I ain't gonna tell you that.
You feel like you OD'ing? You feel like you
ain't Oh, no, I'm definitely not OD'ing. But I'll show you after this. Yeah, I'm good.
How many, okay, let me ask you this.
How many I want?
No. I was gonna say, do you build them? Cause you see,
my money Carlo is pretty much done now. I just got to figure out the rim situation. I got to respray, like everything is done. And I literally dropped it off August, and I'm waiting to get it back now. And I'm gonna go on tour and drop it off again though. But I mean, but look, bro, I realized something too.
Do you love me for real?
Look at you. when pandemic showed me that when you got a lot of cars and you got nowhere to go, what the
facts. That's why I only got one car.
Like, bro, but I ain't got nowhere to go. I just got my G redid. It's a monster.
Nowhere to go.
And, with nowhere to go.
That's why I only got one car, man.
No way. I mean, you here though. You don't even need a whip here. It's just
nah. You need a whip.
I mean, not with gas. You sure you want one?
Nah, you need a whip out here. Oh, okay. You need a car out here.
I mean, you're not going all the way Long Island though. Yeah.
Nah, you just don't want to argue with niggas on the train.
Oh, I mean, but you
on the bus.
I was about to say Uber and taxis. Yeah, you don't want to argue with
like
nobody.
Like I said, you don't want to argue. You arguing with the taxi driver. You arguing with the Uber driver. You arguing on the train with rappers and teenagers.
Yeah, but, oh,
you
yeah.
arguing with the man dancing. You like, yo, my man, son. I'm just trying to, bro, man.
Say worst case scenario, I just argue for this parking space, which is in my car, and they don't even have to hear what I'm saying. Yeah, I don't live. I just, you know, I come.
Nah, but yeah, so nah. Just, so yeah, for my own peace of mind, I drive.
Oh, okay. Yeah, nah. But still, when you got all them cars, ain't nowhere to go with.
Yeah, nah. That's listen. How many you got?
I ain't gonna tell you that.
Thought he was gonna slip up.
No. What? No, I don't know.
So the first two records we played on Digital Roses Don't Die was from the Fire section.
Yes.
I want to get into the Earth section. Okay. On the Earth section,
yeah.
My joint is so cool.
Let's go. Okay.
That was the first. Was that the first single?
First single, and I had the opportunity to direct the video. And shout out to the homie Steve OGFC, which is my marketing person, was like, "Yo, bro, you really need to direct this one." Like I. Come
you up, was what's his name?
Who?
With the paintbrush.
Bob Ross.
Bob Ross.
Yeah, Bob Floss is who I am.
Yeah, Bob Floss. Yeah.
But so doing that, and then shout out to David Kim and even Dutch. Like, yo, bro, do it. It was an amazing experience, bro. But yeah. People don't understand what goes on behind the camera. And it made me change my thought process whenever somebody's like, hey, bro, just one more shot. I'm like, man, I got you. Because you're really trying to make sure I look right.
Right.
Back in the day, I'm like, man, So once I had to ask DJ Wiley Sparks to be like, bro, just one more time. And he was like, and I was like, I get it now.
Yeah.
But once we got the
shot. Took all these years.
All these years to figure it out. So I couldn't wait to get in front of the camera to do what I do.
Right.
And then every time they asked me to do it again, I was like, I got you. Because I know you were trying to make sure I look like great. But it was an amazing experience. And so cool is literally about being with somebody and realizing that financial gain, materialistic things don't matter. It's just being with them in the moment and the energy they give you is enough and sustainable. And normally, and that still comes in the beginning of the relationship, in a sense, because you're still trying to figure each other out.
Answer me this.
Mm-hmm.
When I listen to Digital Roses Don't Die and I listen to other KRIT records, how do you balance as a producer, because you are one, as the kind of executive producer of the project,
okay,
how are you balancing and deciding the leading edge of the sound, right? Because some things that you've done, you hear the organic instrumentation, mm-hmm. but you also hear how you sampled it and kind of reworked the organic instrumentation into a new piece of work.
Okay.
Versus sometimes I hear things that you do and you let the real live instrumentation and the live organic nature of the instruments really lead the sound idea, the sonic package. Right? More than it is just like a hip-hop record. Does that make sense what I'm saying?
I mean, I do. I mean, so this is what happened. There's no samples in Digital Roses Don't Die. So
you didn't even, sample the live jam session that created the song.
We worked on these records, and it's the musicality. And even if it was a concept of it, it's not there anymore. Show You Right is no sample.
Right.
It's like literally sitting in there, and you come up with these ideas. The idea of when I used to make music, it obviously was a sample base, so I would keep the sample. But I wanted to create music that people would want to sample. And then shout out to even Ashanti Mad Violence and Jared Alexander, because Ashanti did produced three of the skits, and Jared produced one of the skits, but there's no sample. So people could take those beds of music, make meditation music out of it, sample if they want to.
Right.
Because we are running into a position where when are we going to start making the music that people want to sample instead of keep going back to the 90s, the 80s, the 70s, the 60s. And that's at the point where I'm at. Like, I'm good. Let me create something in a sense. But it's just.
But even the texture of it, when you decide the mix and the texture and these things.
Well, shout out to Ralph, Parhelium, engineered by Wolf. But grit comes from recording in a space where it's not so pristine.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the records you heard, that's 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, me at the house f***ing off, even my vocals, chord progressions. I'm literally making music when my phone's not going off. It's not like a grand piano and a crazy studio. Yeah. So it can't be clean. The microphone I was recording on wasn't the microphone in the studio. Then we get in there, and then they'd be like, bro, you sure you want to recut this? I'm like, yeah, I'll go recut this. And it just didn't have the same feel. So we like, no, we keep the old. Uh-huh. So you got the air of my room and the...
That's good.
Yeah, the AC blowing.
As a listener, I want that.
The echo, yeah, the door, like guards, like, but all that is to create the sense of I'm still at my grandmama's house and I'm in the bathroom recording music. And the textures, that's how you get it, though.
Crit's here. The, we'll call it the water section.
Yes.
My joint on here in this section is Would It Matter?
Ah. One car shouting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh.
Tell me about that song.
Man, this is when you at that point where you, so it started because it was a huge thing about Birkin bags at one point. It's like, it's just Birkin.
Twerking for
just
a Birkin.
Just not with it, just Birkin. It was just a thing, right? And I just decided to do something like for all the people that can't afford a Birkin, but they still handling things and holding it down. I mean, is that enough? You know, because we do become very, the idea of seeing something so much and then wanting it, but it's like, it's still something that you put stuff in that you really need. What if that's not something you can get? What if I can't acquire the car? What if we still live with my parents, but I'm building towards something that's more sustainable than an item? But wanted to show the duality. That's why the first verse is more tailored towards people who are, you're trying to get it. Second verse is like, we got it. But even that still shows this, but it might not be enough. Because most people, once they acquire things, they want to go back to when they didn't have it. And then vice versa.
Simpler time.
Yeah.
I want to pivot. There's an album, Full Court Press.
Yeah, with the homies.
Was this a pandemic experience?
No.
Was this a...
Nah, that, shout out to Girl Talk, shout out to Wiz, you know, Smoke Dizza. We did these records in 2019. Damn. The world was very much open.
Very much.
And flew out to L.A. All of us have separately worked with Girl Talk. And the homies are amazing DJ and producer. And so he had records of us on our own time. And then it was just this thing like, bro, let's all get together and work. One day, bro, and we got in, and it was like a family reunion. It was like being at South by Southwest in the beginning. And we just knocking records out. And then pandemic hit. I literally didn't hear the full album till 2 weeks ago. Trusted him, Girl Talk with the whole process, the music. And then we all was like, damn, bro, you killed. Because even the sequencing, the mixing, there's breakdowns in the records. When I recorded on them, it didn't sound anything like that. And it takes a lot for me as a producer and an artist to say, you know what, you got it, bro. But I trusted him, and this shit sounded crazy.
Are y'all doing touring?
I mean, we're still trying to figure it out now. The only feature we got on there is Currency, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like we're a part of the blog era, but there's a lot of things that happen musically that never happened before. And this is pre-streaming. First tour I went on was with Wiz. But touring with Wiz was the first time we saw people actually tour off tapes, right? It's like we were the beginning of touring when rap was like, you had to be on this huge tour with big name artists, right? Or you was a rock band. And we out here doing 28 dates, 30 dates, white van, driving up, selling out what would be small venues to most people, but hard ticket sales, people can't do them venues now.
Right.
Right? And that set for me, that set the actual beginning of what you see now as far as the whole idea of being independent.
Right.
Because we were. We got signed, but we still worked as if we were independent,
right,
bro.
And you still had built a touring business and a merch business.
And it ain't stopped, bro. Yeah. I left Def Jam in, 2000 and, 17? Either way, once I left, I said, hey, I'm off Def Jam, I'm independent. I saw more people saying, damn, you signed Def Jam?
Right.
I thought it was more tied to the sundial. And that's what it always was. And so that was we started in 2010, 2011, branding ourselves. My face wasn't even on my covers as much as my brand was.
Right.
And we were on to something. And now it flourished in a way where we could do a whole project and still be relevant and still be doing our thing, though.
Talk about that blessing to other artists, maybe who you have gotten to this point.
Yeah.
Sustained yourself.
Yeah.
Your family, and and fulfilled yourself.
Yeah.
I think I see you as a very fulfilled,
yeah,
grateful human being who has, you know, running their business the way they want to run their business and creating what they want to create.
Yeah.
But that took sacrifice.
Roadless travel.
It's always good because a lot of artists, and I think all of us as young people, you know, when we see somebody successful or somebody living out their dream, we automatically just look at where they are in the moment. We don't really study the path that got to that moment, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah,
or the not so sexy times, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I just wanted to, because I know you are a person that is not afraid of the work, and you did the work.
Yeah.
Like you said, from handing out tapes in your own town to, you know.
Yeah, moving, traveling to Alabama, moving to Atlanta, living in New York, coming back to Atlanta.
Are you, I mean, I couldn't imagine you're anything but grateful and feeling blessed that the road was hard and you persevered.
I'm grateful and I feel blessed, but I think for me, the next step is putting on other artists, though.
Okay.
I think I've been in a position where I've learned so much about this game, and I've been putting it in my interviews. When I see these young cats, I tell them in person, I ask them about their mental health, ask them about the anxiety, what they're going through in the industry. I think the next step is actually really curating a way where when artists sign the multi and they get here, not only can they be their authentic self, but they can actually learn the game and the narrative. Like, I've never been one of those people where I didn't mind telling people exactly what I went through. We was talking about union before we got on this show. And I was like, why, you know, musicians have a union. Most people have a union. Why artists don't have a union? Like, I see mad artists, they go through the process. They either have a hit record, they don't. They get signed and get dropped. They break down. They get on drugs. They go to the streets. But there's no collective to call and be like, hey, man, I need to go to rehab. Hey, man, like, I need help with these bills. Like, I acquire too much. What's a good lawyer I can go to, right?
Or just fighting for an industry standard that everybody gets a
what
standard.
What is the deal I signed?
Right.
This deal, I don't know who to, you know, and so I think we're at a point now with all this information we have, and you got artists that I know made millions of dollars off of their deals, which I didn't, but even they don't want to be where they signed to. Mm-hmm. So who do you talk to? How many people do you put together? How much money do you pay a month to unlock that information with OGs and we all can connect? And then you'd be like, you know what? They're not doing right by this artist. Ain't no music coming out. Mm-hmm. We not dropping today. Oh, that man got killed. We not dropping no music today. We stop. And so I think that's a narrative that is very essential in the world we live in to create some kind of mental health power,
right,
some kind of human level, other than being like, all right, on to the next. Who the new artist? Nah.
How do you articulate to young artists about the vision that it takes to, I guess what I'm trying to say is like, manage your expectations, right? Like, because you had to figure it out for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Of, I think I want this. No, I don't want that. I want this. That didn't work for me. You know what I'm saying? And navigate that business and what was best for you and figure it out through trial and error. And I think there's not a one-size-fits-all approach to
what artists want.
Not at all. But I do think, and I'm not an artist, but just based on what I see, mm-hmm, I do think managing expectations of what the industry will be, what this type of situation will be, and how long it could potentially take versus this time, et cetera, et cetera. How do you help an artist find what's best for them, or how would you imagine that process? Because you say you don't have you never hold back when it comes to communicating with young artists.
If an artist be like, yo, I want to sign a major label deal, I'd be like, bro, if that's what you want, do it. You look at my career, you can't, it might not be the same, like situation in a sense. Every artist I know, even me, I wanted to be on the radio, I wanted to sign a major label deal. I did both of those things. But it didn't work out for me. That's not to say it won't work out for another artist.
And when you say it didn't work out for you, what was your expectation of that?
My expectation was that I go into a building and I would get support, and then I would drop my music, no different than the tapes or the process I did, and it would be full support. And then all the people that still went out and purchased my album, even when the label didn't expect for it to work, it would have been multiplied times that. It was like, oh, bro, we didn't see it here. We didn't know when it came out.
So your expectation was that relationship would take you to a level that you couldn't do yourself.
Exactly.
Right.
But, I mean, the thing is, you can still get to that level. It just takes more time, in a sense. When you're looking at it, especially I was looking at it being a young teenager, I'm looking at you sign a deal and you just take your city and everybody bow.
Right.
No different than any athlete. It's like, oh, I'm going pro. You know, but you don't realize until you get older, it's like, oh, they first deal ain't the max contract.
Right.
It's like, they got to play. So it's literally you go into the game and it's like, oh, the person that signed me ain't even there no more. They leave and then the whole building changed. That's beyond a max contract. That's like your team just got sold to another city. Yeah,
coach left, coaching staff left, like everything gone.
Yeah, and so it was kind of like, you know what, how do I deal with this? And I'm not mad at these people because they just not aware of my music. Deal with it,
and
but
you,
use
and they
it.
Didn't sign you, so they may not even care.
But I mean, care or not, that's not. It was. I remember when I met L.A. Reid and I shook his hand. I signed a contract. Shout out to Shy Money. Shout out to Johnny Shipes and all them. I was like, this is gonna change my family's life. Like, this is it. Then after that, everything changed, and I was like, oh, this when the real work started, because now it's eyes on you. The budget is the budget, but the budget is like, oh, this is that. You can't sample. If you do sample, you got to get it cleared. You clear it, but it don't go through. Oh, it eats all the record. You learn so much in the game so quick. It's like, oh, this ain't nothing like I thought it was. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, this record ain't doing good. Oh, man, we don't really want to push that one. Oh, and so you just move like that. It's like, I maneuvered through it. We toured through it. We sold records through it. And I would tell any artist, man, if you want to go through that process, it might be totally different for you.
Right.
But for me, it didn't work out. But I got that option. If you be like, yo, it's not working out, well, I'll tell you what to do.
And it also sounds like what I'm hearing you say is an artist, depending on your ability to work with, let's call it, the building, the label, the whatever, your experience, mm-hmm. if they are, everything's aligned.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And your desires align with the desires of the label and the people that are there are the right people, it could work out for you.
But that's,
if those boxes ain't necessarily lined up.
That's the human level. There's also a divine, your purpose, and this is what you're supposed to go through level. I have to take consideration, my journey wasn't meant to succeed like that. Mm. I can't tell another artist you won't make it in that world, because that might not be what God wants for them. That might not be their journey. Mine just happened to be that way. But I have that experience enough. If somebody comes up to me and like, bro, they not supporting my music, they not doing this, I'd be like, what's the name of your label? And they'd be like, I don't got no label, start one. Like, what's your brand? What's your merch looking like? Mm. Get that together. Build that. Because once you get off that, once you don't sell enough, once they let you go, that's going to be your net. That's going to keep you safe.
Right.
But I went through that because it was my purpose to go through that. I can't tell another artist not to sign. I would never do that. But I could definitely give them the warning. Right. I was like, hey, bro.
It's a red flag. Watch for this.
Yeah, man, because I never had a hit record. So that's a difference, too. Artists come in the game, they get signed, they got a hit record. Their trajectory is going to be totally different than mine.
Right. All the time and more than roses. Mm,
yes.
On the wind
section. Yeah.
Why is it called, why wind?
It's the turbulent part of your life. Okay. It's when you have to really start making decisions. You grow, you get past the smoke and mirrors of things. And even in a relationship, you put at that point where you know the good and the bad with the person that you're with. It, toxic or not, it's like, or am I willing to deal with this and get past it or not? All the time was more of the narrative where you chase the material things, you buy this, you been out here in the streets, you play a card good, whatever. But if you haven't experienced love, then what are you doing? Mm. Right? And then More Than Roses just sums up the idea of the whole idea of love in itself. And all the time we've actually been around each other, communicated, we've seen each other, took pictures with each other. And that's the overall perspective. It's just about family and love in a sense.
So you were saying you want to play Bury Me in Gold.
Yeah, for all the people that didn't get to grieve during the pandemic, might have lost somebody, you know.
Crazy stories, man.
It's a lot of that,
lot,
and so
the amount of people who lost individuals.
And get therapy, man. Get therapy. Go talk to somebody. It's very important. I encourage everybody to go do it. And therapy is like dating. You might not like the first person you meet.
You just gotta keep getting,
don't be like, oh, the first thing is just, nah, get therapy and don't
it's
live.
Like doctors too, you may need a second opinion.
Don't just go
with the first doctor that say X, Y, Z. Mm-hmm. You might want to go holler at somebody else.
They might, get all them X-rays.
Yeah, MRIs, X-rays, scans, whatever it is.
I could tell we getting older. Look at all this knowledge is dropping right now. Look at the wheels of this shit.
We gotta care, man. I think not enough is talked about with regard to, because look, when you're in your teens and 20s, old heads is gonna tell you, you're gonna be like, yo, shut up, old head.
Mm-hmm.
Stop talking to me. I'm doing my thing. I don't wanna do your thing. But like for me, seeds were planted.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until my mid to late 30s where I was like, oh, they said that. Oh,
you,
that's why.
Yeah. Now
oh,
you're
going, bye,
bye, bye. Now you're checking your liver enzymes, like.
All type. You checking all type. Taking naps. You're like, oh, no wonder my mom was stressing me on the naps. I need naps. You know?
I need to lay my ass down. Yeah.
But I don't think enough is talked about with regard to, you know, young people. And old heads just at least planting the seed. Yeah. I think a lot of times it's like, yo, you know, listen to the kids, and that's cool. And I get why that matters too, to give them space to feel included, to feel loved and uplifted and et cetera, et cetera. But I don't know if enough is talked about where sometimes you just gotta be like,
I mean, look.
The way you moving is not... Like, that whole idea of, like, well, let them figure it out.
You can't let that happen.
Some you can.
Yeah.
But then there's some where it's like, fam, we ain't figuring that out. You moving, yes.
Yeah. I mean, I want all these, like, man, especially, like, the young artists, I want all of them to live long lives. Long lives.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you talk about music, and I mean, all of us have probably seen enough unsungs to know what can happen.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't stop the drug abuse, the alcohol abuse, you know what I'm saying? If you don't seek
everybody
therapy.
Invisible,
like,
bro.
Bro, but it, and so for me, it's like, once you hit, I remember once I hit 30, bro, I was freaking out. Because it was like, I didn't expect to be, make it to 21. I made it 25. Now I'm 30. Now, oh, life is like, oh, I got to get my priorities in order. Like, we talking about, like, life insurance, like this, like, oh, what the, like, I'm not ready for this. When in my 20s, it was like, I wasn't even prepared to live that long.
Right.
I'm just drinking, moving around, I don't give a fuck, like, getting in the shit. It's like, nah, bro, I want you to live a long life so you can take care of your family for a long time.
That's right.
And then change the narrative of the music you put out that made people probably do some stuff that you could afford to get yourself out of.
Right. That's a key.
The narrative is that. Me, I'm literally still working to create the music so I can show people the growth. It's like, I'm not that guy anymore. I shouldn't be that guy anymore. And allow me to tell you why. I learned all this, and then look, that's why that's then, and this is now. And I want all these artists to live a long life so they can do the same narrative.
Yeah, there's a thread of toxicity in what the streets, and because I don't put this on hip-hop.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's more of a kind of a street hustler mentality where it's kind of like, look, I'm going to get mines, and whatever happened to you, that's your dumb ass doing that stupid shit. I was just selling crack. If you want to do crack, it ain't my responsibility. That's on you.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But that thread of toxicity of, like, we are not responsible for the individuals we harm along the way. And that energy has no... holds no kind of a attachment to who we are.
Yeah.
I think is one of the biggest mistakes individuals, because, you know, and by the way, not that I don't have family members that made the same mistakes, not that I don't know people who feel like they do whatever it takes, and if they got to off some people on the way to get to the marks that they set for their bank account and the shit that they own and the power structure that they want to set for themselves.
Yeah.
But I think that threat of toxicity of people thinking that, I just rap about that. I don't really live that life. Like, what?
Baseline, they love their grandmama, though. So we all, human nature-wise, is still somebody that you love. And if they gone, something happened to them, it affects you. So we all naturally have the innate ability to know, I don't want nothing to happen to this person.
Mm-hmm.
The survival instinct happens where you start to look at people like they're not a part of
That's
you.
Right.
You turn 30, you get past all that, you get the money, the ops ain't there no more, you got kids, all that stuff you did comes back on you. So it's really about being able to find that and figure that out before it becomes detrimental to your health.
That's right.
Because I'm pretty sure the richest of dope boys that Clint got good, everything, still had to think about that first time he sold somebody something.
Mm-hmm.
And he got to play that out. He got to deal with it. So I'm just saying now, it's like, man, you got to process it. It's just go through the process and go through the repentance, go through the motions of, you know what, I don't do that no more. I don't feel like that no more. Don't do what I did. A lot of the OGs I grew up listening to, they had those moments. It was like, man, the music changed. And as a young kid, I was like, why they don't? It's like, because they don't have to do that no more.
Mm-hmm.
But that was because I was a young kid wanting to be older versus being older wanting to be younger.
But you also, there's a sacrifice in there.
Yeah, you might not financially gain like you used to. But like I said,
and that threat, that's why I go back to that thread of toxicity.
You got nowhere to go.
Right. That's why I go back to that thread of toxicity, because that thread is what so many of us latch on to as we try to navigate chasing a bag.
Well, we're changing the narrative now. Let's think about this, bro. Last time I had a conversation with you, it did not go this way.
Hmm.
And I appreciate the narrative, but I think I'm at a point in my life. The albums I put out have to be a certain kind of narrative of what I'm really going through. It's like I ain't had a hit. People would say I'm not chasing one, never was, and I'm cool with that. I still get to chop it up with you. I'm still here, I'm traveling, we're doing shows.
Right, right.
So I'm still showing a totally different narrative other than the persona of putting something out there that once you gain, it really don't matter anyway.
Big Crit, ladies and gentlemen, how should we close?
All right, man, you know, you got your drops. I know what I'm going to say.
Do I look at the camera? You do whatever you do.
Oh, look at the, hey, it's your country cousin, Big Crit, third core representative, Mississippi native, is going down, Mississippi, well connected. BigCrit.com, go to tour, get all your tickets. We're going to be out there turning up. Shout out to homie LA and Price. They're going to be on the tour. Y'all know where we at one time. It's the homie. It's the OG. We normally argue up here, but he's going to be in Mississippi real soon. He only got one car. He humble. He ain't tripping. All that wisdom on his bed. It's going down. Y'all know what it is, man. E-Rose, so, hey, we got to talk about it. These are the roses that don't die out right now. Go get that. Spatial audio and all that.
All that. Let me ask you about, real quick, about spatial audio.
Okay.
Because you are a...
shout out to Walter Tucker.
A well-informed studio.
Yeah.
Intellectual.
Yes. Thank you.
You deal with sound. You deal with organic instruments. Matter of fact, this project and many of your other projects as well are great for spatial because of the depth.
There's
a lot of depth for you to play. Talk about spatial and your experience with it and what you've been learning about it.
I ain't gonna front. When I first heard about it, I didn't quite understand. Because I've always been a person that wanted to listen to music and surround, which is like everything like this, right? But that's in a car. I never thought, like, when you're talking about people in their headphones, it's left, right. It's not, you know, it's not, can't hear it in the car. So when I finally got to hear it in the studio, hear it in the car, and then hear it in the headphones, you really get to understand the vocals that I put into it, even like super background vocals that I swear I told him, tuck that low. You can hear it though.
Right.
And it's crisp, and it's still in the, it's weird though, because it's the main vocal is right here, but it's still in the back, and it's building musically.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the first time I've ever been able to listen to music in a headphone like that. I'm used to hearing it in a car. And I was like, wow, like this is crazy.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, spatial, man.
Yeah, they didn't change the game with it.
Yeah, no, it's technology is a very, if done right, like this is, it can be very helpful for the music experience, man, for sure. You say our last conversation. I get the, you didn't like the last conversation.
Nah, it wasn't that it was moments where it was combative. And we was talking about, it was a lot going on with prison reform. We was talking about Mississippi. We was talking about the flag and all that. And then it was like, you was like, I ain't going. And I was like, bro, but how you, people look up to you there, how you ain't gonna go? But it's all good.
So it's interesting because I never thought in the convo that it was bad.
I didn't say it just for me.
Well, you said it was combative. Combative is associated with.
Oh, so I just do a really great job of not showing my frustration.
So you was frustrated?
Yeah.
About which part?
About you not going to Mississippi and talking to kids and shit.
But you took that personal?
Yeah, because I want you to go to Mississippi and talk to the kids because they know who you is.
I never processed that.
Wow. And see, that's what these kind of conversations are about.
It never crossed my mind because honestly, in my brain, I never really thought I wasn't coming to Mississippi.
But you said, I ain't never going there.
No, I said, nah, I ain't going to Mississippi. I don't go to places like that. And but so, in my brain, I go to mad places.
He was like, I would be there.
Yeah, in my brain, it was like, I probably ain't.
So my brain was like, you know how many times I've heard people say that? And then I'm like, bro, you gotta go.
Yeah, in my mind, I never really thought I actually would never actually go.
I'm out here fighting a good fight.